I have one question. Why do you personally care about a worker of color?
What do I personally care about it?
Yeah.
I think that I was drawn to it initially because I really like working as a team. And I find that I do my best if I'm working with others and I have an equitable relationship with others. So I find a great deal of personal satisfaction in it. I also feel that it has an opportunity to be a really just organization and it has been benefits for the country, etc. But probably the primary reason is that I don't like having a boss, but I do love working with others. It's good.
Yeah. I think in California, contractors can't organize as an LLC.
Contractors can't organize as an LLC? Okay.
Anybody who's under the professions code.
Oh, the trades.
Hairstyles.
Okay. Is that a way you're legal?
Sure. Others, I think there are designs of the article. What does
that mean exactly, sir?
Limited liability company?
What does that mean? Like, you can't organize this once, you can't become a co-op, or no, what are you saying, sir?
If you're a contractor, you can hold a contract on license.
Yeah.
You can't organize your business as a limited liability.
Limited liability company is one legal form that you can take, and there are some tax advantages to it, and there are other tax advantages to other legal forms, like a regular corporation or a nonprofit corporation. So people who are organizing democratic firms can choose this palette, and sometimes they choose LLC, but I think you're saying it may not be a good
one. It's not good if you have a contractor's license. If you want to operate under a single person's contractor's license, which is how someone in power operates, you can't do it as an LLC. That's what
right.
Okay.
No.
California.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments
before
I
ask
the mic?
Could you do a little
box for us? Yeah.
What is the typical, you alluded to, what is the typical method of letting someone go who's not pulling their weight, since everybody votes? I'm just trying to.
I don't know that there's a typical way. We do peer evaluation every year. And so those written evaluations become the basis for any disciplinary action when they take the evidence that something has happened and so on. And then we also, if someone doesn't show up, we have a system sort of like put them out of paper, you know, if people don't show up or if they violate some sort of policy. And it's underused. People don't want to like get out of their hat on each other or whatever, but it does happen. Usually, if it starts to happen, it's because it's a serious issue. We'll probably figure out it. And then in our bakery, it would be 75% of if we want to try to make something. I think Rainbow Grocery has an agreements committee specifically for this kind of thing, and they try to pursue mediation before they do.
Yeah,
yeah,
but how do HR laws apply to these waters if there's like a issue, or if there's some other issue
on
that, do you all together
vote,
like,
no,
it wasn't sexual harassment?
I don't have enough legal expertise to answer that question, but I know that there are a lot of cooperatives do pass a policy that if you've got a problem with someone, you have to go to them first rather than trying to bring up a meeting, with sexual harassment being the only exception to that, because it would be illegal for you to be forced to confront your harasser. But I know that there are some exemptions as voters from certain employment laws, but I've really not heard it. So is there somebody over here?
Well, I would just comment that most worker-owned laws are, if they're corporations, corporation has employees, so you have a role as an employee of the corporation. You also have a role as a member of the co-op, which is a corporation. So in a sexual harassment case, your role as employee is what is above everything else in terms of labor law.
Okay.
I mean, you can't have too many conflicts between the roles and so.
So your roles are related to employment.
In that kind of case, yeah, I would imagine yes, very much so.
So just workers in a cooperative? Is like people don't want to join with their skilled workers?
Yeah, legally you can. Your bylaws that you write will determine what whether you want that. For instance, a lot of bylaws say that you cannot have the bylaws, they get, you know, they sort of get a borrow from one organization, approved upon, and so on. So it seems like the majority of bylaws that I see in the cooperatives say that you can't have a certain percentage of just employees, of people who are not on the membership track, so that it basically can't come to the point where there's one person and it's not the only one. But if you wanted to structure it so that people don't have to become members, then you could. I guess another, just as a classic example, there are Sunset Scavenger, who's a worker in a cooperative that started in the 1920s. That person is not right now, but they didn't have any restriction like that, and so they're, as the membership started to retire in the 70s, the membership got smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. And it kind of went along too with them being able to send down electronic bills and things that didn't need workers walking door to door, shaking hands and being owners. But they basically became a sole employer in a closely shared company or something, by just having a few left and everyone died off.
Okay.